Hello everyone, I welcome you all to Legal Dive. I'm very pleased to tell you all that the Legal Dive is going to conduct the online classes pertaining to law of evidence. And by online classes, I mean online interactive classes where you people will have the benefit of on-screen bear analysis, on-screen judgment analysis, and definitely doubt clearance shall also be done. You people will also have the benefit of or the facility of participating in the classroom. So it shall be just like the physical class you'll be attending. All right. And for this, you can DM me for an inquiry pertaining to the online classes of law of evidence. You people will have to DM me and I shall tell you everything there. And definitely, I shall be going to upload two demo lectures pertaining to law of evidence on Legal Dive's Instagram account. Okay, so this is the first demo lecture pertaining to law of evidence. So let's begin with the law of evidence. All right. See, whenever we start a new subject, all right, the first question which has to be answered and which naturally comes every time, it is, what is the nature of this subject? What is the nature of this statute? Nature of law of evidence. Depending upon the nature, you can divide the statutes or acts into two categories: substantive laws, and on the other side, it is the procedural laws. Okay, the substantive laws are those laws which confer any right upon you, or they might be imposing any legal penalty or your liability. On the other side, the procedural laws, they provide for a mechanism, okay, the procedure by following which the rights can be enforced or the liability can be met out. Okay, this is the general thing which everybody knows, but we are talking about quality content here, which is required in mains. You have to write extraordinary answer in the mains, okay, if the question comes pertaining to nature of the law, any subject, nature of CRPC, nature of CPC. All right, so whenever a question pertaining to nature of any law comes before you in the mains examination, you will have to quote a legal maxim. Upon this legal maxim, whole foundation of the relationship between substantive laws and procedural laws is laid out. The maxim is ubi jus ibi remedium. That is, when this maxim is literally translated into English, it means, for every right there shall be a remedy. Because if you do not give the remedy, what is the meaning of giving the right at first place? In case your right is violated, you must have a procedure in order to enforce that right. So this is the whole foundation for dividing the laws into two categories. Now I shall give you an example here, the substantive laws. For instance, the law of contract. It gives you the right to claim damages in case your contract is breached. Section 73 of Indian Contract Act. Similarly, right of doing the anticipatory breach of contract, Section 39. It also creates obligation, contractual obligations upon the parties who have entered into contract. The obligation to perform the contract. This is given in Section 37 of Indian Contract Act. So, law of contract, the Indian Contract Act, is a substantive law. Whole of it is a substantive law. Similarly, you can pick up Indian Partnership Act, which provides for rights of partners and duties of partners in a firm. All right. And on the other side, you can pick CRPC, for instance, Code of Criminal Procedure. How the liabilities or the punishment is to be कैरिड आउट, हाउ द ट्रायल इज टू बी डन. ओके, इम्पोजिशन ऑफ लाइबिलिटी, डेफिनेशन ऑफ ऑफेंसेस इज गिवन इन आईपीसी, बट हाउ द एफआईआर इज टू बी लॉज्ड, हाउ द इन्वेस्टिगेशन इज टू बी डन एंड हाउ द पुलिस ऑफिसर, द इन्वेस्टिगेटिंग ऑफिसर सबमिट्स द पुलिस रिपोर्ट अपॉन विच द मजिस्ट्रेट टेक्स द कॉग्निजेंस, द होल प्रोसीजर, द होल मैकेनिज्म पर्टेनिंग टू जस्टिस डिस्पेंसिंग सिस्टम अंडर द क्रिमिनल लॉ इज गिवन इन सीआरपीसी. सो सीआरपीसी इज predominantly a procedural law. Now let us come to the law of evidence, the subject before us which we have to study. The law of evidence, Indian Evidence Act 1872, is a procedural law. It does not provide for any rights. Okay, it provides for the mechanism, it makes certain facts relevant which can be proved by producing the evidence in the court. All right. Besides this, it also provides for certain facts which need not be proved. Okay, for which you need not give any evidence. For instance, judicially noticeable facts or facts which have been admitted. All right. So this is a lex foræ, the procedural law. It is not a substantive law. Understood? Now, you people may be thinking, why am I calling it lex foræ? Lex foræ, when it is literally translated into English, it means law of the forum. Why the term lex foræ is used for law of evidence or for any procedural law? For CRPC, CPC, Limitation Act. If you open the textbooks, it shall be written that this law is a lex foræ. Why choose lex foræ as a substitute of the term procedural law? The origin of the term lex foræ, it lies in the principles of international law, the private international law. There it is a rule that the procedural law which is to be followed in case of any private international case, a case which contains the element of private international law. For instance, a person is from USA, the other person, the defendant, is from England, and the case is being tried by an Indian court. Then the procedural law which is to be followed by the Indian court is to be the law of the forum, the Indian procedural law. That's why the term lex foræ, the law of forum, is used for the procedural law. And so, in other words, we have made the lex foræ as synonymous for the term procedural law. Okay, the Indian Evidence Act, it is a procedural law. Now you have understood this thing. So you will always have to quote ubi jus ibi remedium as a maxim whenever the question pertaining to nature of any act comes before you. Okay, as far as CPC or CRPC is concerned, I would like to tell you that these are not wholly procedural laws. Why? These are predominantly procedural laws because the right to appeal, it is a substantive right. Filing an appeal is not an inherent right, unlike the right to sue. All right, right to appeal, it is conferred by the statute. It is a right. So whole of CPC or CRPC, it is procedural in nature, except for the right to appeal. So about this was the nature of law of evidence. Now let us open our Bare Acts. Okay, in the class which we are going to have on the online portal, there we will have the on-screen Bare Act. You shall provide it with the on-screen Bare Act in that class. All right, so you have the Bare Acts with you. Now a question which comes in the prelims is that who drafted this Indian Evidence Act? It is Sir James Stephen Fitzgerald. For Fitzgerald, 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 in case you want to write the name. All right, now let us come to the बेयर एक्ट, यू कैन सी द शॉर्ट टाइटल, इट इज रिटन इन सेक्शन 1, शॉर्ट टाइटल एक्सटेंट एंड कमेंसमेंट. व्हाट इज द शॉर्ट टाइटल फॉर दिस एक्ट? इट इज द नेम ऑफ द एक्ट. शॉर्ट टाइटल, इट लिटरली मीन्स द नेम एंड द ईयर इन विच इट वॉज पास्ड. सो इंडियन एविडेंस एक्ट 1872 इज द शॉर्ट टाइटल ऑफ दिस एक्ट. एंड वॉट इज द लॉन्ग टाइटल? सी, लॉन्ग टाइटल जनरली इज द दैट लाइन ऑफ द बेयर एक्ट, द इंट्रोडक्टरी लाइन ऑफ द बेयर एक्ट विच प्रोवाइड्स फॉर द नेचर ऑफ द स्टैच्यूट. फॉर इंस्टेंस, वेदर सच स्टैच्यूट इज कंसॉलिडेटिंग इन नेचर. ओके, इज इट कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव इज इन नेचर? इज इट अ कोड और नॉट? इज इट एन अमेंडिंग एक्ट? ओके, सो फॉर दिस 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 इंडियन एविडेंस एक्ट वी डू नॉट हैव एनी लॉन्ग टाइटल, वी हैव द प्रीएम्बल. ओके, इन केस एन एक्ट डज नॉट हैव द प्रीएम्बल, इट हैज द लॉन्ग टाइटल, द सेम थिंग. सो दिस इज द प्रीएम्बल, वेयर एज इट इज एक्सपीडियंट टू कंसॉलिडेट, डिफाइन एंड अमेंड. ऑल राइट, दिस इज द प्रीएम्बल. इन अदर एक्ट्स, द लेटेस्ट एक्ट, दिस इज एन ओल्ड एक्ट 1872, बट इन द लेटेस्ट एक्ट्स, द एक्ट्स, मोस्ट ऑफ द एक्ट्स पास्ड आफ्टर 1900s, यू शैल फाइंड the long title here. It won't be the preamble here. Okay, so short title, long title, preamble has been done. We come to the application, the extent of this act. Okay, now in the section 1 para 2, it is written it extends to whole of India except the state of Jammu and Kashmir. You can cut it down because Jammu and Kashmir Reorganization Act has been passed in 2019 and it applies the whole of Indian law, which applies to rest of India, applicable to the state of Jammu and Kashmir as well. Okay, so the Indian Evidence Act, it applies to J&K as well. Then you may underline, it applies to all the judicial proceedings in or before any court, and also all the judicial proceedings in court martials, all the judicial proceedings before any court, or all the judicial proceedings before any court martial. But other than the court martials convened under the Army Act, Naval Discipline Act, and Indian Navy Act, these three acts may be underscored, may be underlined. Okay, it applies to the proceedings conducted in court martials, but not the proceedings conducted in court martials convened under any of these acts, Armed Forces Acts. Okay, if court martials convened under Armed Forces Act, then Evidence Act will not apply to such proceedings. Then again, you have to underline, it does not apply to affidavits, but not to affidavits presented to any court or officer, nor to proceedings before an arbitrator. Okay, so three things have been included: court martials convened under these acts, second, it does not apply to affidavits, and third, to proceedings before the arbitrator. Now a question of interpretation comes before you. What is an affidavit? See, affidavit, it is a declaration given by a deponent. Deponent means the person who is giving the declaration. In the affidavit, he says that this fact, I affirm it to be true as to my knowledge. I am aware about it, so I affirm that this is true. I am affirming it before the court. Okay, it is just like a proof. I am proving you, I am giving my word that this is true because I know it. This is affidavit. Sometimes it may be written that paragraph number 2, I acknowledge it to be true, I affirm it to be true as to my belief. If he is aware about the truth of the fact, he will say that I affirm it as to my knowledge, I affirm it to be true as to my knowledge. If he is not aware about the fact, but rather he heard it from someone and believed it to be true, he will say that I believe it to be true. For instance, in case of any legal fact, a fact pertaining to jurisdiction most of the time is mentioned in the plaint that this court has the jurisdiction. Now a layman will not know whether the court has the jurisdiction or not. ओके, बट ही हैज़ टू फाइल एन एफिडेविट, दिस इज मैंडेटरी इन प्लेन्स. ऑल राइट, सेक्शन 26 सेज दिस ऑफ सीपीसी दैट एफिडेविट हैज़ टू बी देयर अकम्पनीड विद प्लेंट. यू हैव टू प्रूव द फैक्ट्स रिटन इन द प्लेन बाय फर्निशिंग एन एफिडेविट. He does not know, the deponent does not know whether the court has the jurisdiction or not, but the advocate, his legal counsel has told him that he has the jurisdiction, the court has the jurisdiction. So he heard it from his legal counsel and believed it to be true. Okay, so this is affidavit. Now CPC, it allows the court to ask affidavit from any party to prove any fact. Court may ask any party to give the affidavit to prove any fact. This is written in CPC section 30. You may say this has, see section 30, there it is clearly written the court has the power to ask from any person to issue to give an affidavit for proof of an fact. So affidavit is a substitute for evidence, okay, for any evidence. But upon affidavits, Indian Evidence Act does not apply. Definitely in CPC, court has the power to ask affidavit for proving any fact, for proof of any fact. Next we come to arbitrator. You already know what arbitration is. Arbitration is an adjudication done by some independent body which is not a court, okay, and no court intervention takes place there. It is maximum party's autonomy upon which arbitration is based. Then it shall come into force on 1st day of September 1872. You have to remember this date, okay. This date is also there for the Indian Contract Act. Both the acts, they have the same date of commencement, 1st day of September 1872. Underline it. Section 2 has been repealed. We come to section 3, which is interpretation clause, okay. So first definition is court. The court includes all judges and magistrates and all persons except arbitrators, because arbitration for in proceedings relating to arbitration, the Indian Evidence Act does not apply. Legally authorized to take evidence, this has to be underscored. Judges, magistrate and all persons who might not be magistrate, who might not be judges, but if they are competent to take evidence, they shall be called as court. Why? Can you think of an example where a person who may not be a magistrate, who may not be a judge, but still he has the power to take evidence? Commissions, Order 26 CPC, where a commission is issued by a court, the commission, it has the power to take the evidence on oath. So for the purposes of Indian Evidence Act, the commission is considered as a court. Then we come to fact. Fact means and includes. Whenever a definition clause uses the word means and includes, it means this is an exhaustive definition. Nothing lies out of this beyond the words given in the definition. This is a complete definition of fact. First one is anything, state of thing, relation of things, capable of being perceived by the senses. You may underline these words: thing, state of things and relation of things. Capable of perceived by the senses, you know that we have five senses, okay, sight, smell, taste, you can listen, and fifth one is you can touch. Okay, so these are the physical facts or external facts which are mentioned in clause 1 of the definition. But in clause 2, it is any mental condition of which a person is conscious. This is an internal fact for example, any state of mind. For instance, let us take example about knowledge. The fact that he had the knowledge about he had the knowledge about the coin being a counterfeit, that the coin was a fake coin, a currency was the fake currency. He had the knowledge about this thing. Okay, so this is an internal thing which can be there only in the mind of the person who knows it. Knowledge means awareness about a fact. Okay, so this is an internal fact, but in clause 1 it talks about physical facts or external fact. Let us read the illustrations, it shall be more clear thereafter. Number 1, that there are certain objects arranged in a certain order in a certain place is a fact. Thing, state of things and relation of things. Thing, for instance, I shall say this is a chair upon which I am sitting. This is a thing upon which I am sitting. What thing? The chair. State of things. Okay, this is made up of what kind of material? Is it a metal chair? Is it a wooden chair? Okay, so this is the state of things. If I am saying wooden chair, chair made up of wood, it is reflecting the state of thing. Relation of things. This chair is placed alongside the table or in front of the table. Okay, it tells about the relation of the things. Clause B, illustration, that a man heard or saw something is a fact. Okay, it was a physical fact which he saw. C, that a man said certain words is a fact. Again, this can be perceived by any of the five senses, as was the case in clause B. Again, physical fact. D, that a man holds a certain opinion or has a certain intention, acts in good faith or fraudulently, or uses particular word in particular sense, or is it or is or was at a specific time conscious of a particular sensation is a fact. This relates to the second part of the definition, the mental fact, the internal fact. Okay, the state of mind or any opinion of the person. E, that a man has certain reputation is a fact. Okay, reputation is also an internal fact because people, they keep it in mind. It is the external manifestation of the person's character. What do you think about certain person in your society? Is he a social worker? Is he a good man? Okay, this is in your mind. This too is an internal fact. Now, a question of interpretation comes here, which may be asked in mains. That is, fact. Let us take an example. The fact that God exists or does not exist. I'm making the statement, the God exists. Is it a fact? Or the God does not exist? Is it a fact? You may say that it is a certain opinion which a person may hold. Okay, or is it an external fact? But let us first settle upon this thing, whether it is a fact or not. The God exists or it does not exist. No, it is not a fact. Why? Because for anything to be fact, under law of evidence, it must have the potential to be proved in the court of law. It must be capable of being proved in the court of law. You cannot prove the existence of God in the court of law, nor you can deny its existence in the court of law. That is why this is not a fact for the purpose of law of evidence. Similarly, ghosts exist or ghosts does not exist, do not exist. This too is not a fact because it cannot be proved in the court of law. However, if I say A believes in existence of God, this is a fact because it can be proved in the court of law that A believes that the God exists. A is not an atheist person. Okay, so it shall be then it shall be the internal fact falling in the second clause of the definition of fact. Understood? Now let us come to the other part, the next definition, which is relevant fact. The relevant fact. One fact is said to be relevant to another when one is connected with the other in any of the ways referred to in the provisions of this act relating to relevancy of facts. What does this mean? This talks about relation. Okay, a relevant fact a fact can be made relevant only if a connection is established with fact in issue or another relevant fact. Okay, and this connection, okay, the basis of this connection is given from section 6 to 55. Relevant facts are mentioned from section 6 to 55. One more thing, the Indian Evidence Act, it does not make any logically relevant fact as relevant. It makes only a legally relevant fact as relevant fact. By legal relevancy, I mean relevancy, the connection, the nexus given from section 6 to 55. Not by any logic you can make the facts relevant. The Indian Evidence Act from section 6 to 55 decides the relevancy, and only these facts are relevant. And such facts are either related to fact in issue or relevant fact. In res justi under section 6, those relevant facts, they are related only to fact in issues. In rest of the sections, the facts which may have been made relevant might be related to any other relevant facts. Okay, so the relevant facts, they are also known as factum probans. You may write down the spellings factum space probans, probans. Next comes the fact in issue. This shall be the last definition we shall be dealing in this lecture. Okay, the first demo lecture of law of evidence. Facts in issue. The expression facts in issue means and includes. Again, this is an exhaustive definition, complete definition. Any fact from which either by itself or connection with other facts, that is in connection with relevant facts, the existence, underline, non-existence, nature, extent. Four things are there: existence, non-existence, nature and extent of any right or liability or disability. Asserted or denied in any suit or proceeding necessarily follows. Okay, fact in issues are those facts which are disputed in the suit or proceeding, asserted by one party and denied by the other party. This definition is too given in order 14 of CPC rule 1. Okay, what is an issue? Issue of a fact asserted by one party and denied by other. Upon fact in issues, the existence, non-existence of right or the liability, it depends. Also its nature and extent depends. Now one thing that has to be understood, the fact in issues, they arise from the substantive laws because the rights itself are conferred or given in the substantive laws. Okay, if fact in issues, they relate to the existence, non-existence of a right or liability, definitely these rights, the fact in issue, they arise from the substantive law. For instance, whether the contract exists or not. If it exists, it has to be performed. All right. If it does not exist, it need not be performed. These might be the facts in issue in the suit for specific performance. Similarly, in a suit for damages under Section 73 of Indian Contract Act, the facts which might be in issue are whether the contract exists or not, or whether the person, the other one party, it has done the breach or not. Okay, because accordingly damages shall be given. All right, so they arise from substantive laws. Also illustrations are given. You may see the illustration: A is accused of murder of B. At his trial, the following facts may be in issue, that A caused B's murder, B's death, because accordingly the liability shall follow. If he has caused B's death, it may be a case of murder, it may be a case of culpable homicide, not amounting to murder. It may also be a case of causing death by rash and negligence act, 304A. Second is that A intended to cause B's death. If he intended to cause B death, then the case squarely falls in first clause of section 300. It shall be a case of murder. Third, that A had received grave and certain provocation from B. In that event, the nature of liability changes. It shall not be a case of murder, but shall be the case of culpable homicide, because exception 1 to section 300 will apply. Accordingly, it shall become the culpable homicide, not amounting to murder. That you, so you can see, okay, even in illustration, these facts, they arise from the substantive laws. Okay, that A at the time of doing the act which caused B's death was by reason of unsoundness of mind, incapable of knowing its nature. Section 84 of Indian Penal Code, which is a general defense of legal insanity. If it is applicable, then the accused is totally absolved. He shall be deemed to haven't committed any offense. Okay, so these facts, fact in issue, they arise from substantive laws. While relevant facts, they have been made relevant by the Indian Evidence Act from the section 6 to 55. Some sort of connection with other relevant fact or fact in issue has to be established, and the nature of connection, it is given from section 6 to 55. This much is sufficient for mains and prelims. Just one thing is left, which is fact in issue. We have a name in Latin for fact in issue, which is factum probandum. factum probandum, factum probandum. And fact in issues, facts in issue, they are also known as principal facts. Okay, let us read the explanation first. After that, I am ending the class. Whenever under the provisions of the law for the time being in force relating to CPC, civil procedure, any court records an issue of the fact to be asserted or denied in answer to such issue is a fact in issue, again asserted and denied by the other party. But if it is admitted by the other party, then it shall not be a fact in issue. This explanation, it pertains to Order 14 of CPC, which talks about settlement of issues. Okay. So this is it for first demo lecture of Law of Evidence. I shall be uploading another demo lecture pertaining to Law of Evidence. If you have any doubt as regards Law of Evidence, which has been covered by me in the first lecture, you can ask your doubts in the comment section, or you feel free to message me, DM me. Also, regarding any inquiry pertaining to the classes, the fee which is to be charged, anything, feel free to DM me. Okay, so thank you very much. That's it.